From the film Sweet November, that is Amanda Ghost with Uninvited. The song reminds me of just somebody that is really not perhaps in your league, maybe, or I don't know. Weird. It reminded me of something in my past, but we won't go there. We'll keep it nice and on the up and up tonight. How about that? All right, this is Debbie here with you on Friday night, bored out of my mind. Victor is, of course, where do you think? In the garage, working on his project car. Oh. But he's got that little baby out there with him working, and it's so cute. Kids are so damn cute. Why do they grow up? Why can't you buy a puppy that stays a puppy? Why can't you buy a kitten that stays a kitten? And why can't you have a child that stays a child? Some children are great. Some children are not so great. Some children come out and decide the moment they take their first breath, they're going to wreck your world. Some children come out to be absolute treasures in your life. This child is an absolute gift from God. He's an absolute angelic angel. Oh, he is so sweet. Oh my God, he's adorable. But he's all boy. He's all swords and Batman and guns and, you know, just everything boy. He's 100% boy. There's no doubt about that. Last night's show. Well, I don't know. I think it's just best off we leave it a memory. I learned my lesson about taking calls from people that I don't really know all that well. Andy Bong just invaded the show. I mean, it was just horrible. He was rude. He was loud. He was obnoxious. He was everything that I didn't want. And I tried and tried to be nice. Well, he concocted that since I didn't just let him completely steamroll, that I was mean. He went over and Goofy's room and was going, "You're right, you're right." So I'm whatever, you know, I understand he's special needs, but you know, and that's fine. I understand more than you think I do about special needs, but whatever. I like Andy. I thought I liked Andy. It's kind of a weird situation to tell you the truth. So for any of you, I know about 100 people heard it already. So if you heard it, I don't know what happened either. But something definitely happened. It was weird. So we are here on Friday night doing nothing really, just kind of hanging out, and I didn't know what to talk about. But I thought I would just play some songs, and whatever goes on, goes on. Now, the next song I'm going to play for you guys is by a guy. From the 60s and the 70s. His name was Alice Cooper. I first came to know Alice Cooper music when I was very young, and my uncle loved an album that was called Billion Dollar Babies. Now, being raised in radio, I used to hear music constantly. We heard music more than we heard anything, and talk radio. There was always this music from Billion Dollar Babies. Everything was Billion Dollar Babies. And he played it just, you know, anytime he would just go over and put a record on his record player, whatever you call it, his stereo or whatever, he would always choose this green album. It looked like a snake. It was just green. It was, you know, a big, you guys don't know what that is. It was like a record. It's hard to describe. But anyway. And there was a song on there I used to hear all the time that it wasn't mainstream. But I thought, even though it's got the most bizarre lyrics, I thought that in some form or fashion, now if you listen to my music, I always like what we call over here in this family, the black keys. Okay, and what we mean by that is it's always that kind of a off key, you know, kind of the minor. You know, on the keyboard, the black keys, and you'll notice that the song I just played is kind of a, you know, must be strangely appealing. You know, it's just kind of an eerie sound. This is even more eerier than that. But again, it's Alice Cooper. It's from Billion Dollar Babies. And here we go with I Love the Dead. But pay attention to the song. It's beautiful.
Dead before they're cool, the bluing flesh for me to hold. Cadaver eyes upon me see nothing. dead before they rise. No farewells, no goodbyes. I never even knew your now rotting face. While friends and lovers mourn your silly grave, I have other uses for you, darling.
Creepy, but pretty. I know it's weird. The next song I'm going to show you guys and see if you like it. I don't know. I have weird taste in music, but it's a song about a woman who is, I think she's married. I'm not sure. I really get into the lyrics of songs. I think that's what the poet wants you to do. The writer. And I haven't really figured it out completely, but it seems like she's almost using him for whatever, you can let your imagination be the judge of that. But it seems to me that she doesn't love him. Maybe even she's had a relationship with him before where he's hurt her. And now she's come back just for one reason and one reason alone. This is a very Texas song. Not very well known, not mainstream. An unbelievable song. It was another song from a film starring Sandra Bullock. No, excuse me. Not starring Sandra Bullock. Excuse me. It's from the movie The Horse Whisperer. This is A Soft Place to Fall.
Daylight has found me here again. You can ask.
I just remembered something else about this song. This song has got what I love about country and Western music. Now, down here in Texas, we don't really do the plunky plunk and the wanky twank. We're not really into that, but we're into just good, rich sounding country music. Country music tells a story. Country music will reach right down and touch your heart. But the thing I want to tell you about this song is the twin fiddles. Now, of course, we know fiddles are violins. And when we have twin fiddles, it's where they harmonize with each other. There's two of them playing the same thing, but they're harmonizing. And this song has twin fiddles in it. So that's all I wanted to say. Here we go again.
Daylight has found me here again. You can ask me anything but where I've been. Things that used to matter seem so small when you're looking for a soft place to fall. Don't misunderstand me, baby, please. I didn't mean to bring back memories. You should know the reason why I called. I was looking for a soft place to fall. Looking for a soft place, nothing more than a smile. Of a love that ended long ago. Looking for a place to hide, a warm bed on a cold night. I didn't mean to hurt you, no. Looking out your window at the dawn, baby, when you wake up, I'll be gone. You're the one who taught me after. Find a soft place to fall. how to find a soft place to fall.
Like I said, you're the one who taught me, after all, how to find a soft place to fall. So it looks like to me she's been with him before, broke up with him, whatever, he did her wrong, and you're the one who taught me how to do this shit, buddy, is what she's saying. Now, I talked a minute ago about Billion Dollar Babies. Billion Dollar Babies is, I think, Alice Cooper, well, it's not his opus, but I do believe it's what he will go down in history for. That, and of course, School's Out for the Summer. That's a huge one that I used to play every year when I picked the kids up at school. And this one is one of his huge, hang on a second, one of his huge ones. And I queued it up. Here we go. This is wild. A lot of people love this guitar riff in the very first beginning. Take it away, Alice Cooper.
Midnight Movie, and when I'm angry and sweating like a hog, nothing takes away the chafing better than Gold Bond. I squirt it all over my face and my body, and that keeps away the chafing monsters. When I do my radio show, and somebody aggravates me and makes me angry, and I'm yelling and screaming and sweating like a pig, I use Gold Bond.
First time we met is a favorite memory of mine. They say time changes all it pertains to, but your memory is stronger than time. I guess everything does change except what you choose to recall. There's a million good daydreams to dream on, but baby, you are my favorite memory of all. Like the night we made love in the hall, slept all night long on the floor. Like the winter we spent on Lake Shasta, alone and closer than ever before. And I remember that London vacation, it was you made the whole thing a ball. There's a million good times I could dwell on, but baby, you are my favorite memory of all. The first time we met is a favorite memory of mine. Say time changes all it pertains to, but your memory is stronger than time. I guess everything does change except what you choose to recall. There's a million good daydreams to dream. My favorite memory of all.
I'd like to dedicate this one to Alpha Dog. We're from America. That is, you know who, Marilyn Manson. Marilyn Manson, who is a very interesting, crazy person. I love him to death. But I was working today. When I got home, I went working out with my daughter. And I don't think I've ever sweated that much in my life. And I'm sitting here looking. I still have my leotard on, the top part. And it's got white salt all over it where I was sweating so bad. That was a good workout. I was really sweating up a storm. I am, of course, Debbie here with you on Friday night. I just put out a notice to somebody that I want back so much. And I told him, I'm begging. I'm absolutely begging. I will not divulge his name, but if he would come back on this new platform that I'm on and co-host with me again, I would be so happy. I would be so happy. Because he can handle the situations that we get into over here with these idiots. And I have found the best way to handle it is I just don't listen to them. I don't go to their shows. I don't listen to their podcasts. Because they're just people that I got in on a bad crowd. That's all I did. And the reason that I don't quite fit in with them is very simple. I don't fit in with them. I'm not that kind of person. I don't do things like they do. So my best wishes to all of them, but whatever. You know, today I was in a chat room of my friend Peter. I was invited to come to his show and I'm in there chatting and I get attacked by Rick. Rick's like, Debbie, I know that you banned me and I don't know why because I don't give a crap and blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, you know, can I not go to one of my friend's shows without one of you coming around and starting your bullshit? You know, I'm like, just leave me alone. Get over me, for God's sake. Get over me. So, shouts out to Rick. But, you know, buddy, I don't beg anybody to do anything with me. That's just the way I was raised. I'm cocky. I don't care if you like me or not. If you don't like me, then go away. Does that make any sense? Duh. I used to work in a library a long time ago, and I know that sounds kind of nerdy, but I did. Oh, by the way, I have it fixed to where I can't see my chat room anymore, so if you're there chatting, I can't see you. I got sort of a special situation given to me. I can't see the chat room anymore. I don't want to see the chat room. I don't care to see the chat room. It's nothing. If you're out there listening, shouts out to you, whoever you are and wherever you are. I don't really want to bond anymore with people on this network. I do and then I don't. I will and then I won't. I love Deshaun. There's a few people I've met on here that I really like. Most of them I don't trust. And it's going to take a lot to get me back in your good graces, whoever you are. The reason I don't have David on the program with me much is because David got very upset when Wild Goose doxed him and put his docs out. I don't want David around for right now until some of this blows over. You know, because I can handle more than David can, and he got upset, and I'm like, you know, he doesn't need to be involved in this situation right now. Just so he's got his own show. He's got a show on iHeartRadio, and he never does it. He never does it. He never goes on and does anything. It's all about Asperger's. And there's so much to talk about, so much to teach, so many things to do that he could be doing, and he's not doing it because he wants to stay over here in this drama. And I'm like, David, you're always welcome on the show, but there's too much drama surrounding the show, and they will attack him. You know what I mean? And even though they're not worth it, and they're just kind of just idiots, whatever. I mean, and I say that with all sincerity, because for people to do what they do, they've got to be stupid. I mean, would you see me going over and attacking somebody on their freaking show? Are you kidding me? Now, I'll leave a shitty comment sometimes. There's no doubt about that. But that's just me being mean to them because they've been mean to me. Anyway, I used to be a librarian. I know it sounds funny. And we had three or four record players back there in the very back. This was in the, let me think, probably early 80s, okay? Definitely. And we had like three albums in there that had been brought, that were snuck in behind everybody's backs. the main people that work, you know, the main librarian and stuff. Well, a friend of mine brought up an album. She was a lot older than I was, and she brought this album up there, and we used to listen to it on this with these headphones on. And this song came out, I think, in 83, 82, 84, 81. It's by a group called The Babies. And every time I used to listen to this in that library, I used to think, oh, this is so sweet, but yet so sad. Here it is from The Babies.
Every time I think of you, it always turns out good. Every time I've held you, I thought you understood. People say a love like ours will surely pass, but I know a love like ours will last and last.
Stop saying it. Okay, I'm going to go to my email because I'm getting flooded with Dear Debbies. I mean, it's ridiculous. Some of them are from the same person. I mean, some of them are, but not all of them are. This one comes from 10-Minute Email, which means somebody wrote this and they don't want me to know who it is. But it sounds like a guy and it says, "Dear Debbie, I am 43, single, never married, and I have no children. It seems like now in the dating world that that is a red flag. In your early to late 30s, it seems like it was a magnet for women. But now that I'm in my 40s, I'm starting to ask, what is wrong with me? What do you think?" What do I think? There's nothing wrong with you. People think that they have to fit a mold. They have to graduate from high school, go to college, get a bachelor's degree, get a job, get married, have two kids, buy a lawnmower in the suburbs, mow the lawns, and that's not right. All of us aren't right. All of us aren't alike. It's what I wanted. It's what I wanted all my life growing up. I wanted a family and a home and the lawnmower and the golden retriever, the whole bit, and that's what I shot for. That's what I wanted. Although I lived a pretty wild life before that. Jesus Christ, I was Madam X. But anyway, it's like, why would you think something's wrong with you? Don't compare yourself to people that are cookie cutter. There's nothing wrong with you. I've often said many times that a person that is willing to admit that they do not want children, in my opinion, are smarter than so many I have seen that have done it. And I know they did not want those children. I can think of two guys right now that got married to friends of mine, girlfriends of mine. I was in 1,000 weddings. You know what I mean? I'm exaggerating, but I really wasn't a lot. And I know that they didn't want kids. They just didn't want them. In fact, I've heard them say many, many, many times when we're over there watching the Cowboy game or whatever, "Get these kids out of here. Get these kids away from here." And that's just not, when Victor looked at his children when they were small, he was amazed at their big faces and their big brown eyes and their big smiles and the way they would say, "Daddy," you know, and he couldn't get enough of it. In fact, it's hard for him to watch video when they were small. And speaking of videos, we were watching a video the other day, a home video. Heather, my daughter, she's very pretty. I'm very proud of Heather. But she came out a little dictator. She was, for lack of a better word, a bitch. She was. We called her Queenie. I nicknamed her Queenie because she just had this air of royalty about her. Okay, just like, for example, there was one video we watched that was hysterical. Heather was 5 years old. We were living in Plano, and I had bought her this big, pink, beautiful bicycle. I mean, it wasn't big. It was a little small one. It had a basket on the front, and she was nuts about it. She got a cowboy hat. She was just really weird. Well, she also got a gift that was a doll from her Aunt Regina. There was a doll on one side. It was like a suitcase. When you opened it up, there was a doll on one side. On the other side, there was all these dresses and outfits and shoes. And Stephen would get so jealous of Heather's birthdays. And it was so cute. They're just two different people. Well, the video has Heather in the kitchen and we're messing with the doll and I'm on the floor and I'll never forget. It makes me so jealous because when I see me, I've got this long blonde hair, straight as a board. And I turn and I look up at Victor and I said, "Are you filming me?" And I think, "Oh my God, I look so young and so beautiful and so pretty." I mean, it's just, you know what I mean? When you see video of yourself like that. Well, anyway, and all of a sudden Heather goes, "He hit me." And it was the way she said that, because Stephen was trying to get to the doll and everything or whatever, just messing with it. And she was like, "Stop it." And she goes, "He hit me." And it just sounded like something a queen would say. Well, the video I was going to tell you about, though, was we were at Disney World in Florida. And Heather was in one of those pushing buggies. She was sitting in it. And I think it was like, it wasn't Disney World. One day we had gone to SeaWorld And she was in one of those dolphins that you push the kids around in. I had one for Steven and one for Heather. And Heather was sitting in hers, and we were sitting videotaping this beautiful little babbling brook, this little tiny river that kind of went all the way through the park. And Heather just dominated Victor. I mean, it was just like she had just found a servant practically. And I mean that it wasn't bad. She wasn't tacky or anything, but it was just cute to watch Victor. He was in love with her. And there's some sort of a bug or a bee or something that's landed right there on that little buggy that she was in. And she sits up real straight and she goes, "Dad." And I turn the camera over to her and she's going, "Get that bug right now. Get that bug." And she's just like ordering him. And Victor's over there going, you know, trying to get it. But it was just so funny to watch her just order him to get that bug. You know, and it was just, I don't know. It's probably boring y'all to death to hear about it, but I don't care. But no, you know, some people want that. Some people don't. I wanted it. Victor wanted it. We both wanted it. And that's what we got. Now, we have a friend of mine named Randy who has a girlfriend named Terry. They don't want kids. They've never wanted kids. In fact, they've never gotten married. Gotten. I've always wondered if gotten is a word. They never got married. And they're fine. They're happy. They're loyal to each other. And he's bought her beautiful rings before. In fact, I think she would get married, but he doesn't want to get married. But they've been together forever, since she got out of law school. And she practices at one firm, and he's in private practice. And they've never been married. She's never had a baby. She doesn't want babies. There's nothing wrong with you. Now, if you are 43 years old and you've decided that you're ready to get married, that's fine. It's not too late. Men can have babies until they die. But a woman's baby time runs out, I think, in her like mid to late 50s or whatever. So, no, I don't have a problem with that at all. And I, excuse me, I don't think there's, I mean, quit thinking there's something wrong with you. Are you joking me? You know what would be wrong with you? What would be wrong is if you did what I saw two other people do, what I won't mention their names, got married to a girl that they didn't really want to marry. I mean, they loved her, but they didn't really want to get married. Had two or three children, and they're now miserable. They're miserable. They never changed a diaper. They never fed them. They were just very absentee parents, and I always thought that was horrible. Truly. Thought it was horrible. So no, dude. Live the dream. They are expensive. They are expensive. I'll tell you what. They are expensive. Children are very expensive. Are you joking me? If I were to sit and try to put pencil and paper to what I have spent on my kids, I don't know that I could do that. I mean, if starting from the beginning with diapers, the furniture, moving into toys, food, bottles, formula, clothes, medical expenses, are you kidding me? There's probably a bottom figure of six figures each. Now, I overspent a little bit on the kids, but you know, that's just me being me, but. Anyway, I think I'll read one more and see what this one to me. I read it the other day. I've had this one for about a week. Dear Debbie, my father-in-law was taken care of in hospice before he passed away. We live 8 hours away from him. We drove up, stayed several days, and every day we thought was going to be the day. But he seemed to just keep hanging on. My husband had purchased tickets previously to an event with one of his friends, and he went. Since his father hadn't passed away, I said, "Sure, go." Well, guess what? While he was at the event, his father passed away. I have mixed feelings about this. It's not my dad, I just need to support my husband. But now that I think about it, was it right for him to go to this event? What do you think? What do I think? Are you sure you want to hear my answer? I think it was very selfish of him to leave his father in that predicament. And why I say that is I have experienced a dying parent, my father. My father, on New Year's Day, he had been over to see us on Christmas, and he was very thin. So thin that I was like, wow. You know, his clothes were falling off of him. I got into my, I'll never forget it, I had a little white Beamer, a little Beamer 325. I drove over there, and I parked in front of the house. And for some reason, I just remember, oh, I know why I remember that car. I'll tell you in a minute why I remember that car. And I said, I went up, knocked on the door, and he goes, hey, sissy, come on in. And I said, nope, I'm not coming in. He goes, what do you mean? What's wrong, sissy? And I said, I'm going to sit on this front porch until you get in the car and go to the doctor with me. And he got so pissed off. He was like, God damn it. You know, I said, I'm not. I'm going to camp out right here. Where are the babies at? I said, they're with Victor. And I sat there. I said, I'm not leaving. I've got my cigarettes. I've got my water bottle. And I'm fine. And I'm going to sit right here. Okay? He went in, closed the door. I would say 5 minutes to 10 minutes later, he says, all right, come in the house. I said, nope, I'm not coming in. He got so pissed off. Well, we went to the doctor. I drove him all the way back over to Plano to a very nice hospital. We walked in to the emergency room. We let him know that he was very, very thin and he had developed a cough. Well, we go into one of the examination rooms and they send him down the hall to get chest x-rays and we come back. Well, he had this little thing on his finger that was reading his blood oxygen level. Now, my father was very afraid of cancer, very afraid of it. And the guy walks in and he goes, you know, your blood actually looks pretty good. Your white blood cells are not that elevated. I saw an expression come over my father's face that was so sweet, I will never forget it. And the reason I remember that car is me driving my father over to that hospital. For the first time in my life, I was in control and he wasn't. And that was a big, big, big deal. My mother had been gone for quite a while. Well, anyway, we're sitting in there and the guy, the first doctor leaves. He goes, okay, we'll be brought back with you. And we're sitting there and he goes, well, what do you think? And I was like, I don't know. And he goes, maybe it's just bronchitis. And he began to be chipper and he was cutting up and talking about stupid things when they played golf and how stupid Victor was. He always shanked it or, you know, all this kind of stuff. Well, in walked three doctors. And they said, Mr. Beep, we're here to discuss your x-rays with you. And I looked at him and his eyes were this big. I saw fear in my father's eyes for the first time. My father was afraid of nothing, nothing, maybe a nuclear warhead. And he said, do you want her in the room? And he goes, sissy, why don't you step out for it? I said, sure, no problem. I walked out, picked up my phone, and I called Victor, and I was like, I think it's bad. And I couldn't hear anything. And then I saw the doctors walk out. And I walked in. And he said, can you see the x-rays? And I said, no. And I reached over, and I turned the lights back on the x-ray boards. And it looked like pieces of cotton all over his lungs. And I said, what is that? He goes, it's cancer. And I went, God damn it. I was like, shit. I said, Daddy, what did they say? He said, maybe 3 months. I was like, I was in shock. I mean, I just stood there like, You know, here's this man I'd known all my life, and I just realized I had about 90 days. He died 3 months and 2 days to the day. And it was horrific. It was just him and I. We sat and we died. Now, having said that and told you that story, front row tickets to see Jesus star in Jesus Christ Superstar, I would have turned down. Because that's a very special part in someone's life. Dying is very scary. Because no matter who you are, no matter what you believe, you're fixing to move from one dimension into another. And you don't know. You don't know if when you close your eyes that you're going to start seeing, you know, big demons. You don't know if you're going to go burn in hell. You don't know. You don't know. You don't know if you're going to float around the world as a spirit. You don't know. And it's so scary. And I bet the father-in-law, baby, I bet when he realized that his son had gone away to some event, which I'm sure it's some tickets to a football game or whatever, he just thought, F it. I'm out of here. I think that's very sad. No, I will not give you any comforting words. I think it was crappy and a very, very, very bad decision on the part of him. Now, I don't say very often that people do songs, redo them, and I like them, with the exception of Michael Jackson when he did He Rolled the Coaster, He Got Early Warning. What is that song? He Got Spot. I mean, I thought that Steve Tyler, my close personal friend, did it good until I heard Jackson. When Michael Jackson did that, I thought, wow, sorry, Rolling Stones. But this is another one that I think actually outdid the original. I'll be right back.
No one knows what it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man. Behind blue eyes, and no one knows what it's like to be hated, to be faded, to telling only lies. But my dreams, they aren't as empty as my conscience seems to be. I have hours, only lonely. My love is vengeance that's never free. What it's like to feel these feelings like I do, and I blame you. No one bites back his heart on their anger. None of my pain will can show through. But my dreams, they aren't as empty as my conscience seems to be. I have hours, only lonely. My love is vengeance that's never free.
Discover. like to be mistreated, to be defeated. Behind blue eyes, and no one knows how to say that they're sorry. And don't worry, I'm not telling lies, but my dreams, they aren't as empty as my that's never free. No one knows what it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man behind blue eyes.
Microphone. I've got to do something about my microphone. It's messed up or something. The plugs are. Anyway, I'm back. I was playing with a speaking spell, and here it is.
Now, spell oven.
It doesn't work when I push the buttons. I don't know. It says, this is so weird. It turns on and then it turns off, but I can't. Wait a minute.
Now spell once.
O-N-C-E. It doesn't say the letters.
Incorrect. Now spell angel. A.
Here we go.
N. G. E. L. Correct. Now spell it. Incorrect. Now spell says. J. P. S. U. C. K. S. Incorrect. Now spell view. D. E. B. I. D. A. L. Y. Incorrect. Now spell warm. I. L. O. V. E. M. 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 Incorrect. Now spell danger.
Danger? Okay. Listen, guys.
G U Y S H E A. Incorrect. Now spell watch. F U C K G O O F.
Why?
Incorrect. Now spell watch.
Already, shut up. Go to bed. That's the speaking spell. Zeki and I played with that one night. We had a ball on my show. Why did I name this Moose Bit My Brother? I don't know. It was just a stupid... I'm trying to move my microphone. Listen to it. It's on one of those arms, you know, that come out over the desk. And Victor tightened it up and he's so stupid. So there you have it. I made it spell L-I-M-P. But that's what they're using in that song. Where is my switchboard? What did I do with it? Where is it? I don't know where it is. It's somewhere. It's in Firefox. I never pay attention to what I'm doing. I'm just sort of play like a kid on this stuff. All right, we have, what are we going to do now? We did that, and we did that. And, oh, this is a really cool song. We did that one already. And we did this one already. And here we go. We'll listen to this and then I'll come right back on. How about that? Okay? Here we go.
I had a great year last year. I got married last year to Barbara, my wife, a wonderful woman. And, Barbara was actually Jeff Foxworthy's interior designer when I met her. So not only was Jeff really responsible for my success in my career, but he also introduced me to the woman I'm going to spend the rest of my life with, which I think makes us even. Barbara's my age. I didn't marry a kid, you know. I married somebody that really stimulates me intellectually. Very smart girl, 2 degrees, great business head. Now, she's also very sexy. She's a beautiful woman. But if I could give advice to the planet, it would be don't marry for looks alone, going either way. And I'll tell you why. In a few years, if Barbara's boobs start to sag too much, there's a place you can go where they can just lift them right back up where they were. And they can move the nipple wherever they want them. You can actually go to a titty bar, pick out a set of titties, and say, I want those titties on that woman right there. Right? If her belly gets too big and she doesn't want to work it off, you can go get a tummy tuck. They'll give you a belly that looks like a cheerleader. You know, if your eyes go bad, you can have LASIK surgery and they can give you 20/20 vision at any age. If your hearing starts to fail, they can put a device in your ear that'll make you able to hear as good as you could the day you were born. But let me tell you something, folks, you can't fix stupid.
I said mellow mood. Anyway, folks, it's a mood. Just had my butler turn the lights down low. He came in unannounced.
Nothing like dead air. Well, Victor, it's all Victor's fault. It's all your fault, Victor. Mm-hmm. Everything in our family, it's Victor's fault. Victor, I was telling a story earlier about when we were in Florida at Disney World. And we have that video of Heather when she saw that bug on her stroller and she's going, "Get this bug right now, Daddy!" Like that. It was, I don't know why that. I just remember that for some reason. Victor's a really, this song is for all of you guys out there to think about your dad when you hear this. It's a really pretty song by Cat Stevens. And thank you for that compliment, dear. Get away from me. God, Victor, please.
It's not time to make a change. Just relax, take it easy. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to know. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. I was once like you are now, and I know that it's not easy to be calm when you found something going on. But take your time, think a lot. Why, think of everything you've got, for you will still be here tomorrow, but your dreams may not. And I try to explain. When I do, he turns away again. It's always been the same, same old story. From the moment I could talk, I was ordered to listen. Now there's a way, and I know that I have to go. Go. Change, just sit down, take it slowly. You're still young, that's your fault. There's so much you have to go through. Find a girl, settle down. If you want, you can marry. Look at me, I am old, but I'm happy. Keeping all the things I knew inside. It's hard, but it's harder to ignore it. If they were right, I'd agree. But it's them they know, not me. Now there's a way, and I know that I have to go away. I know I have to go.
I should have known earlier about President Bush, but I gave him some rope, a lot of rope, and then he hung all of us with it. I should have known it when I heard him say, when it comes to evolution, the jury's still out. What jury where? The Scopes trial is over. never thought that during the course of my life that a president would be elected who didn't believe in evolution, or at least kind of in the ballpark of it, or thought, maybe it's got some merit. But no, he believes that the earth was created in 7 days. Whew. Takes my breath away. And why does he believe that? Because he read it in the Old Testament, which is the book of my people, the Jewish people. And that book wasn't good enough for you Christians. Was it? He went, no, we've got a better book with a better character. You're going to love him. And you called your book new and said our book was old. And yet every Sunday, I turn on the television set. And there's a priest or a pastor reading from my book and interpreting it. And their interpretations, I have to tell you, are usually wrong. And it's not their fault because it's not their book. You never see a rabbi on TV interpreting the New Testament, do you? If you want to truly understand the Old Testament, if there's something you don't quite get, there are Jews who walk among you. And they, I promise you this, will take time out of their very Jewy day. And interpret for you anything that you're having trouble understanding, and we will do that if, of course, the price is right. Was the earth created in 7 days? No. For those of you who believe it was, for you Christians, let me tell you, then you do not understand the Jewish people. We Jews understand that it did not take place in 7 days, and that's because we know what we're good at. And what we're really good at is bullshit. This is a wonderful story that was told to the people in the desert in order to distract them from the fact that they did not have air conditioning. I would love to have the faith to believe that it took place in 7 days, but I have thoughts. And that can really fuck up the faith thing. Just ask any Catholic priest. And then there are fossils. Whenever anybody tries to tell me that they believe it took place in 7 days, I reach for a fossil and go, fossil. And if they keep talking, I throw it just over their head. There are people who believe that dinosaurs and men lived together, that they roamed the earth at the same time. There are museums that children go to in which they build dioramas to show them this. And what this is, purely and simply, is a clinical psychotic reaction. They are crazy. They are stone cold fuck nuts. I can't be kind about this because these people are watching the Flintstones as if it were a documentary. Now, there is a big difference between the Old Testament and the New Testament, and that is the New Testament God is really kind of a great guy. He is, especially when you compare him to the Old Testament God, who is a prick. I don't know what happened to God, you know, over time, how he matured, if he went to an anger management class. Or maybe just the birth of a son calmed him down. But before he had the kid, holy fuck, he was out of control. All you gotta do is read the Old Testament. It's unbelievable. Look at Abraham, the first man to have faith in one God. And what does God do? Hey, Abraham, come here. Come here. Bring your kids. Let's barbecue them. Moses spends his life, crosses the desert with them, 40 years devoting to his people to get them out of Egypt, across the desert to the promised land. And God goes, hey, Mo, you're not getting in. Kiss my ass. Ha, ha, ha. Oh, there's a guy you want to work for. The reason that the Old Testament God is a prick was because the Old Testament is designed as a book to get the Jews to straighten up and fucking fly right. Because they were out of control. They were 10 hairs away from being baboons. And that's the point when I do that in the South, that you can hear the veritable fucking pin drop. Figure it out, okay? You watch Jerry Springer. That's what we're like now. Imagine what they were like then. They needed rules. They needed to know that marriage takes place between a man and a woman. Because they were wandering into camp with camels going, I'm in love. I don't give a shit what you are. You can't marry a snapping turtle, asshole. But it's not good enough for our president that it's written in the Bible. He felt it was just an imperative that we have to put it in the Constitution. And so do many states. Because apparently we heterosexuals have reached a point we're so fucked up that we better write it down in case we forget who we're supposed to marry. It's unbelievable. It's in the book already. What, do you need to print it? Are you crazy? It's... But in the midst of all of our problems, that was the most important thing to him. We have no energy policy, you know, none whatsoever. We still don't have a good one. It's ridiculous. And if you ask, we're not going to have solar energy in my lifetime. You know, few people have it, but it should be something we all have. It's ridiculous. I'll take no flying cars, but solar energy? And if you ask your congressman why, he'll say, because it's hard.
I was sitting over here cracking my ass up when he was doing that, and so was Victor. That was for Victor. He's listening to me in the other room. He's one of my biggest fans. And he said he wanted to hear Lewis Black and the other Lewis. He has two favorite Lewises. One of them is a singer-songwriter from the, I think, the 50s that Victor finds so amazing that this guy was basically suffering from, he was either autistic or Asperger's. He was definitely special needs. But special needs people, I believe the reason they call them special is because they're special. They usually have some amazing talent. They're usually extremely gifted at something. It may not be communication, but it may be something else. And this fella amazed Victor when we saw the film depicting the story of his life, his biography. I don't think it was an autobiography. And it was true. Everything about him is true. Now, he got shunned for a while because of things that went on and blah, 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 blah. However, my husband sees him, as did my very own father, as somewhat of a musical genius. I give you The Killer.
And I'm just out of school, like a freak, real cool. I got the jump, got the jive, got the message up and live. I'm a wild one, I'm a wild one. Ooh, yeah, I'm a wild one. I'm gonna keep it shaking, I'm gonna keep it moving, baby. Don't you cramp my style, I'm a real wild child. Come on, baby, shake all night long. I shake till I beat to come home from the bone. But I'm a wild one. Ooh, yeah, I'm a wild one. I'm gonna keep it shaking, gonna keep it moving, baby. Don't you cramp my style, I'm a real wild child. Get that sugar, but don't be late. We're gonna move it all night long. Yeah. Oh, a lot of shaking going on. I'm a wild one. Ooh, yeah, I'm a wild one. I'm gonna keep it shaking, gonna keep it moving, baby. Don't you grab my style, I'm a real wild child. Oh! The sun goes down, all the after dark, I can get around. Gonna move all around, make it a hop. When we start to bump, and I say, okay, stop, but I'm a wild one. Ooh, yeah, I'm a wild one. I'm gonna keep it shaking, gonna keep it moving, baby. Don't you cramp my style, I'm a real wild child. I'm a real wild child, I'm a real wild child. I'm a real wild child.
Let's calm the fuck down. It's obvious people have come here with some sort of an expectation, and that puts a lot of pressure on me, and I don't respond well to pressure. Nice to be back in Atlanta. Nice to see that you've really have worked out your traffic problems. You don't give a shit about it, do you? I guess this must be my sixth appearance here, and every time I beg the audience, you know, I plead with you, do something, and nobody seems to give a fuck. Try as hard as I can to explain that you're living a psychotic lifestyle and you don't care. Got too many people. Too many fucking people. But you don't give a shit, do you? It's like, oh, yeah, let's build out there. Yeah, we'll keep fucking... Stop it! Okay? Stop it! At what point do you just say, hey, no more fuckers can live here? Six lanes of traffic. And nobody moves. I mean, that's just unbelievable. And what's truly extraordinary is those signs you put up over the road, the electronic ones, the ones that say, oh, you have 4.5 miles to go from Kiri to Kaka. And it'll be 45 minutes. Why do you do that to yourselves? You know, instead of that, why just don't have a big middle finger like that? I mean, let's get a grip on it. There's no reason to put up the length of time that you're going to wait. Because you know what you take away? Hope. At least the other way you can go.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness and gracious, great balls of fire. I lighted up the water, thought it was funny. You came along and moved me, honey. I changed my mind, this love is mine. Goodness and gracious, great balls of fire. Kiss me, baby. Ooh, it feels good. Hold me, baby. I want to love you like a lover should. You're fine, so kind. I want to tell the world that you're mine, 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 mine. I chew my nails and I squint over thumb. I'm real nervous, but it sure is fun. Oh, baby, drive me crazy. Goodness and gracious, great balls of fire. Baby, I want to love you like a lover should. You're fine, so kind. Tell the world that you're mine, 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 mine. I chew my nails and I twiddle my thumbs. I'm real nervous, gonna be sure it's fun. Oh, baby, drive me crazy. Goodness of gracious, great balls of fire.
And that is Great Balls of Fire by Jerry Lee Lewis, 37 past the hour. And I'm Debbie. And this next one goes out to, and even if he's not here now, he'll be here one day, to Deshaun. He loves this song. It's so cute. And it's a mashup. And I think it's cute that he likes this song. Here we go. Michael Jackson, the Jackson 5, and our beloved of Nirvana. And I know a lot of people take offense at that when it comes to Nirvana, but whatever. It's just six of one, half dozen of the other. I don't know why I said that. I was going to do something. I'm trying to do something right now, but I'm just going to sit here and bloviate for a minute. I could read another Dear Debbie. Shouts out to Audrey out there listening on her iPhone. The beautiful, gorgeous, talented, and ever on my mind, Audrey, who I love more than anybody. Well, I can't say that. Well, I don't know. I may. I really do. I think she is the neatest thing in the whole world. Just love her to death. She's a mess. She is a mess. And she sends me a text message. I miss your shows at night. I said, I'm on the air. Where? On Spreaker, you mullet. So she's over here. Let's hear a quick, where did it go? Did I have it up here still? Yeah. Let's listen to a, well, hold on, Debbie. This is live radio here. Now, I'm looking for a song that I upload. There it is. Okay. We talked a little while ago about the song Come Together. And I told you guys that the original song, Come Together, was, of course, as we know, done by none other than the Beatles, correct? They did a really great version of it. I believe Come Together was written by, as we all know, John Lennon. I think. I could be wrong. I think. You know, he bagged production. He got Warris Gumboot. He got Ono Sideboard. He won Spiral Cracker. He got feet down below his knees. You know, Yoko Ono, I mean, there's a line in there. He got Ono Sideboard. It was probably written by Paul McCartney. I don't know if anybody knows. Just call the station. So, you know, as we know, they did a fine version, which I don't have a problem with. It went well. Here it is. The Beatles with no shoes on the feet of Paul McCartney as they cross the road, Abbey Road.
Here come old Flat Top. Here come grooving up slowly.
Okay, which was all good and well, all right? Then we had Steve Tyler step up, and he took a shot at it, which when I first started hearing this back in the 90s, I thought, wow, not bad, okay? And he did a pretty good version of it, right?
I love that show. How many episodes behind are you guys?
Oh, my gosh, I can't wait till your commercial's over, so we're going to mute you. And seriously, a lot of people loved it. My brother was like, you know, we're into music. Like I've told you many times, we were raised with music. So here's their take of it. So we thought that was all good and well, or at least I did. I thought, okay, that's good. Okay, good, not bad. I mean, I can't do it, obviously, but, you know, okay, I can handle that. But then we had one version come along that, in my opinion, blew all of them away, and that was when Michael Jackson took a shot at it.
Down to be a joker, Yes, I just want to say that Stoic Calm wins, and I'm treating myself to some sugar-free cookies after the show. And I'm, yes, I don't want to say that I'm proud of myself, but yes, I believe that this is a lesson for everyone that deals with bullies. Remain calm and don't let it get to you. Let it roll off your back. You can win with Stoic Calm.
I am all for women that decide to get plastic surgery. Plastic surgery allows you the rare opportunity to make your outer appearance resemble your inner appearance. Fake. Thank you. That's right. That's a very positive joke for women, unless, of course, you have fake boobs. Let's be honest, you're not bright enough to get that joke. How's that feel, whores? Yeah? Keep telling yourself you did it so your shirts would fit better. You did it because you're a whore. You forgot because you're stupid. You've been to a third world country? Not a tit job in the bunch. Yet they still find happiness. Oh, isn't that boring? We have shows like Extreme Makeovers. I don't want to develop a personality. Just cut my face. And stretch it and staple it. Now I'm happy. Or at least I look like it. Put me on Extreme Makeovers. I want a vagina under my arm. I don't know if they can do it, but that's extreme. I signed the waiver. Let's go, Doc. Drill. That'll be on during sweeps and...
Shut up for a minute. Hold on. Shut up. I want to talk to you people about something that hit me like a ton of bricks about an hour ago. I'm sitting here thinking about things. And I was sitting here thinking, and I need some music. I need some background music. I was sitting here thinking that the people on the network here, on the platform here, that are ringing the victory bell. And they're thinking, boy, we really got her. Yeah, we really got her. We really got her. Ha ha ha. We really got her. No, you didn't get her. And I'm going to tell you why. When you come from abuse as a child, okay, and I explain, shut up, Audrey. Oh, who said it's my birthday? Who says it's my birthday? Everybody's telling me happy birthday. It can be my birthday. Did I say it was my birthday? Well, happy birthday to you too. A very merry unbirthday to you. Anyway, when you come from child abuse, and I said something to Heather the other day, we were watching that little boy that lives here with us play in the den. And he was just playing so happily, just hopping around, boinky, boinky, boink, and playing with this and playing. He's a very happy child. Very, very happy child. Stop it, Deshaun. And that's my text messages on my phone. And I said to Heather, I was struck to say this to Heather. I said, she was over there doing dishes and everything. And I said, Heather, do you see how happy the baby is? She goes, yeah, why? I said, and I sat down on the bar stool and I said, well, I want you to listen to me for a second. This is like one of these learning moments that I do with my kids. I said, do you see He's 3 years old. He doesn't have a care in the world. Not a care in the world. He doesn't even have a girlfriend yet, a mortgage payment. He's not in any kind of peer pressure situation. He wakes up and plays all day with mama watching over him. He's living the time of his life right now. Now I want you to imagine somebody that age that never even got that. They lived in constant fear. Their own mother was a monster. And that's who you're looking at. And I survived by the grace of God and by the blessings from my grandmother and my extended family. And I understood my mom. And I came to grips with it at a very young age. My mother was sick. She had problems. And my father didn't want her medicated. And I was her victim. At the age of 6 months old, my mother tried to put poison in my baby bottle and panicked when my eyes began to roll back in my head, and she rushed me over to my grandmother's house, who took me to the hospital, and they all had whatever, and it was a big mess, and everything went crazy, and I'm fine. This went on for years and years after that. But if you trolls think you can hurt me, right, sure you can. Bitches, I am made of steel. Now, I'm very emotional. I will cry at the drop of a hat. Poor Mr. Midnight movie. I was crying buckets the other night when I was talking to him. I was so sad. I was like, oh, I was so sad. And that's fine, because that's what real women do. We are what is called emotional. Emotional. When you have a female as a friend, that's what they do. Now, if JP did that to him, I would go, and I would rethink the situation. But it wasn't. It was me. And after knowing him for over 2 years, and that's the only second time I've ever cried around him, I think that's pretty good, because I am a real person. I am a real female. I'm very female. And boo, hoo, hoo. Now, bringing us to our next point of business here. I adapted, very young. This is the song that I think represents me. I used to hear this all the time. When I was growing up, my father and my mother had record albums all over the house. They had stacks of them. They used to have them in those crates made out of real thin pieces of wood. Okay? We've still got a bunch of them. I've got my dad's 45s. This was an album cover. This was an album that was just beautiful. And this, whenever I would hear this song, I would think, at a very young age, I even knew, that's me. So if you think you can hurt me, right.
A winter's day in a deep and dark December. I am alone, gazing from my window to the streets below, on a freshly fallen silent shroud of snow. I am a rock, I am an island. I built walls, a fortress deep and mighty, that none may penetrate. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. It's laughter and it's loving I disdain. I am a rock, I am an island.
verge of feelings that have died. If I never loved, I never would have cried. I am a rock, I am an island. I have my books and my poetry to protect me. Is me. I am a rock, I am an island. And a rock feels no pain, and an island never cries.
Mr. Midnight Movie, and when I'm angry and sweating like a hog, nothing takes away the chafing better than Gold Bond. I squirt it all over my face and my body, and that keeps away the chafing monsters. When I do my radio show and somebody aggravates me and makes me angry, and I'm yelling and screaming and sweating like a pig, I use Gold Bond. Bond. Bond.
Think of younger days when I lived for my life. Was everything a man could want to do. I could never see tomorrow. I was never told about the sorrow. And can you mend a broken heart? How can you stop the rain from falling down? Tell me how. Can you stop the sun shining? What makes the world go round? And how can you mend this broken man? Can a loser ever win? Somebody please help me mend my broken heart and let me live again. Still feel the breeze that rustles through the trees, and misty memories of days gone by. But we could never see tomorrow. Would you believe that no one ever told us about the sorrow. So how can we make a broken heart and mine is? How can you stop the rain from falling on my house? Stop us, that old sun from shining. What makes the world go round? And sometime I have to say, say, la la la, la la la, yeah. I just wanna live again, baby. How can you mend this broken man? Yeah. Somebody tell me, how can a loser ever win? Baby, I'm gonna say, baby, help me mend this old broken heart. I thank God, I feel like I wanna live again. How can you mend this broken heart? Somebody please tell me, how can you stop the rain from falling down? Although my clothes are all wet, tell me, how can you mend my, please help me mend my broken heart. I think I believe I got a feeling that I want to live. La 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 la.
Special meaning because we were like one of those really weird couples that shut up, that didn't have a song. We didn't have like our song, you know. Oh, I don't think a lot of people do. And when you get married, they're like, well, what is your song? And I was like, I don't know. And Vic and I were more excited about going to Hawaii than we were this wedding. I mean, I was like, okay, I have the dress, the bridesmaids, the groomsmen, the tuxedos, the flowers, the food, the booze. That's all fine, but let's get to Hawaii. That's all we cared about. We were like, screw all these people, you know, whatever. And the song that I heard on the radio one day, just going to work, I heard that song that sounded like a beach. And let's take a walk together near the ocean shore. And I thought, that's going to be our song that we dance to. And it was really pretty. But it was funny because when we were dancing, that song actually starts off really slow. And then it starts going faster at the end. And it was really funny because they were like, oh, well, now we want to have the couple out here on the floor. And I was just getting polluted. And there's so many memories about that wedding. God, that was funny. We almost missed our flight the next day, and our luggage went to Cincinnati, and we went to Maui, Hawaii, and that was just hysterical. And all the honeymoon pictures for the first 3 days I've got on just clothes that we bought, that I bought while I was there. It was a mess. People would walk behind us and go, Maui, Wowie, Maui, Wowie. Victor actually bought some. It was hysterical. Anyway, long stories, funny stuff. So, yeah, again, shouts out to Audrey that's out there listening somewhere in the interwebs. But that's called that's by Kool and the Gang. It's called Cherish. And although it's really weird sounding now, everybody's wanting me to play that stupid thing I did the other day. And I'll play it. But is it funny? I don't know. My daughter thought it was this. My daughter was cracking up when she heard it. Literally, she was losing it. Literally losing it. And she was losing it when the second voice comes in. Check it out.
Hello, all you beautiful people out there in Spreaker land. This is Bootsy McGee here on Spreaker.com. And I'm here to talk to you about haters. You know what they say, haters gonna hate. And you know that's right. Haters is just gonna hate. Now, we have some interviews here today. Our first interview is with our friend, Lester the Molester. Lester, how are you today? Well, that's just really, really good. And what do you know about haters? Can you tell us about haters, Lester?
Why, yes, I can. I'm Chester the Molester, and I'm here to tell you that I am only 22 years old, but I'm here to talk to you about a hater on this here Spreaker.com, and her name is Debbie Daly. She is 153 years old, and she is the driest old hag you've ever seen in your life, and she's an old talent hack, and she's a hater. Oh, she's a drama queen, too. The loneliest old twat you ever saw in your life. And us down here in Texas, now you know I'm here on my brother-in-law, Johnny's radio station, because he lets me be on here. I ain't got a wife. My wife done left me years ago because I'm an old piece of shit. I'm fat, I'm old, and as a matter of fact, if you look at the picture of me on my show page here, that's the best picture I've ever had took, and I look like shit in it. So you can imagine what I look like in person. What about you, Bootsy?
Oh, no, you don't. You're not going to get me to talk bad about Debbie Daly. I actually love Debbie Daly. Because you know something? They may call me Bootsy McGee here on the network, but I'm really a boy. I'm a boy. I'm a male. And I hate haters. As a matter of fact, I hate everything. I hate you. I hate me. I hate my mother. I hate my brother. No, wait a minute. I don't have a brother or a mother. I forgot. I hate my dog. Do I have a dog? I got a cat. That's the closest thing I've ever come to pussy anyway. And I'm going to tell you what. But I've got this person that I'm going to sue. I'm gonna get everything she owns. Everything she owns. And I can't wait to I'm sitting across from her, and I can say, "Hey, you old mean thing, I'm going to get that quilt on your bed, and I'm going to burn it, and I'm going to say, yee-haw, ding dong, the witch is dead, witch-o-witch, did you go to see Wicked? I love going to see plays and orchestras and stuff like that. You know, I'm married. I am married to a man that I love, and I am so rich. Ooh, I drive a BMW, and I make so much money, but I never have to work. I don't know how I get all my money, but I don't have to work. Isn't that funny? You know, a lot of people think I live here with my mother, but I don't. I promise I don't. And I'm half Italian. My daddy was Italian. But I hate my daddy, and my daddy hates me. I only love my mama and my grandma."
Bootsy, that's got to be the sweetest thing I ever did hear anybody say. Now, I'm going to remind you one more time that I'm Chester the Molester. And I am here. Excuse me, my name is Lester the Molester. I'm sorry about that. And I'm here on Spreaker.com to tell you, do not go over to the Debbie Daly Show. She is so old and so dried up, and she's a nasty old twat. You stay over here at the Lester Show, where we've got talent, and we've got brains, and we've got better than that. We've got a brother-in-law named Johnny that got on iHeartRadio. Now, I didn't make it on iHeartRadio, nor did my friends, and we're out to wreak havoc on this network until they all hate us. I gotta go now, Bootsy. It's been fun being here on your show, babe. I'll talk to you next time. Until then, this is Lester the Molester saying goodbye, everybody, and don't forget to hate Debbie on the way out.
I shudder. All right. The other night on another show, I did readings for people on the air, and I was actually pretty blown away at their responses because I don't know these people. I didn't actually need their birth date. I needed just the day and the month of their birth. And goodness, there was just this jealous boy on there the next night, this little fat boy named Johnny Molson. He was just like so jealous, you should have heard him. But I blew him away. If you want to hear it, it's the archive show of October 20 of the Jay Sands late night talk thingy. It was the 20, hell, I don't know. It was a Thursday night, 24th, I believe. October 24th was his show that I was on. I was doing readings, but I enjoy it. I don't know. What the heck? I never claimed to be good at it. But when it comes to you, Deshaun, now the way this happens is I get different words, and I'm getting powerful, conscience, autonomy, unique. In fact, you are so unique that you will sometimes change your opinion just to conflict with other people. My Labrador Retriever just opened my door. I kid you not. Here he comes. Come here, Bubba. Come on. Come up here. Come up here with Mika. Come here. No, come over here. Come here. Come on. He's getting up on my bench with me. Come on, Bubba. Come on. It's real hard for him. Come on, Bubba. This is a 120-pound Labrador Retriever. Come on, Bubba. Come on. He's chocolate brown. He's a brown lab. Hello, my love. What's wrong? What's the matter? I kissed his nose. Are you okay? How come it has a big sad eyes? What? Are you hungry? Can you hear him go? Are you hungry? I love you. I love you. Can you talk for the people? Huh? Can you talk? No, not right now. Okay. Big boy. Can you sit there while I read this person? Anyway, you are so unique, and you want to be unique. You don't want to blend in with anybody, and you don't blend in with anybody. Now, you have difficulty making friends, and when you do make friends, it's somewhat of a complicated process for you. You often will hang out with people that are different religions, different backgrounds, different lifestyles. He always sits right up next to me and it feels so good. Now, you have a powerful connection to your... Well, bless your heart. What was that big sigh for? Hold on. I'm almost off the air, okay? We'll go out there and eat something, okay? Victor laughs because he eats everything I eat. If I eat it, he eats it. If it's ice cream, he gets ice cream. If it's a sandwich, he gets a sandwich. Yes, you do. They're just people with tails. That's what I tell people. Now, you have a strong connection to your childhood, but you experienced something in your childhood that forever marked your life, forever altered the road that you were on. You've always felt very insecure about the way you look, your appearance, when you were little, I'm talking about when you were young. If you ever have children, you will be an excellent parent, because I get the words parenting and excellent and things like that. You are very much in control of your spiritual well-being. You are the sunny side of life, is the way you look. If I had to pin a song on you, it would be, "Always look on the bright side of life." And I'm getting like guru, spiritual counselor, something along that lines. And I don't know what that is. I'm thinking either you follow one or some sort of like a Hare Krishna type person that you enjoy, you read. People that know you through the internet don't really know you. They don't know who you are. They don't know where you're from. They don't know anything about you. You're a very strong individual. You're a survivor. You hit a lot of bumpy roads in your life. Now, I know that from reading your book. I can't lie. That's not me reading you. That's me from reading you. As a matter of fact, I had his book on this computer, and I would love to close out by showing you, some of his writings. And this is, of course, everybody knows him, everybody loves him, and that's Deshaun. Deshaun is, of course, my Spreaker husband. And we met, it's so silly. I mean, Victor knows it's just goofy. We're just being silly. But we met in Jay Sands' room one night when we were having an absolute ball. I was cutting up with Jay and laughing. We used to have so much fun. And I'm getting the word money, handling, assets, careful, fear. You must be very careful with your money because you have a fear that you're going to lose it at any time. You've been without, and we all know that. If you've not ever read Deshaun's book, I suggest you ask him for a copy of it. It's quite amazing. I thought I had it on this computer. I don't know if it's on this system or not. I don't think that it is. Taking a looky. As Mr. Midnight Movie would say, let's take a looky. No, I don't think it's on here. No, I don't think it's on this system. I think it's on another system. So let me take one more peek under documents. Of course, I have a Macintosh, so it's a little bit different than what everybody else has out there. Ooh, wow, that jumped real too far over there. Jumped too far. I don't think it's on here. I think it is not on this system. That's too bad because I was going to read you some out of it. It's really good. I know where it is. It's over on my Skype under Dash's, where Dash has sent it to me before. Happy birthday. Somebody must think it's my birthday, but it's not my birthday. Let me see if it's still on here. He sent me a copy of it on Skype, and maybe I can still download it again. I don't know. Scrolling up. No, I can't find it. It's not on this system. Dad, burn it. Well, Desh, if you're out there listening, if you want to shoot me a copy real quick, I'd love to let some people know just exactly what you're capable of. It's weird. He is so intelligent and so talented. You know, my brother once said something that stuck with me all my life, and that was, the sign of intelligence is the ability to write. That's what you learn in college, is how to write and how to speak. And I love writing, and I've always loved writing. I think I'm somewhat good at writing. I don't know, maybe not. Maybe someday I'll read you some stuff out of my book. But I was going to close out with that, but Desh is not answering me, so I don't know if he's out there listening or not. But anyway, it was really neat too, damn it. I shouldn't have talked about it because now I don't have it. But he sent it to me on Skype, and again, I will repeat that I don't see it. I was going to re-download it, so I'll give him a couple of seconds and see if he answers and if he can shoot me another copy of it. Maybe it was in one of these group chats. Let's see if it was in this one. No, I don't see it. Nope, still don't see it. I'm just looking. Drinking at Hotmail. Reuter is so silly. He is so funny. Well, he's not answering me. So anyway, all right, I guess Deshaun signed off. But if you ever get a chance, ask him for a copy of his book. Damn it, I wish I had it to show you guys. It's amazing. It's shocking, not because Deshaun is anything, but it's just shocking no matter who you are. It shocked me. I was like, shit. I think it's on his webpage. Let me take one quick look there, and if I don't find it, I'll kill it. I always say, I'll kill it. You mullet. Where'd you go, you mullet, Deshaun? Deshaun is being a mullet tonight. Deshaun Mullet is his name. So yeah, okay, where am I? What was I going to do? Oh, I was going to look up his website. I think it's on there. Could be wrong. Let's take a looky, as Mr. Midnight Movie says. Let's have a looky. Is it obvious who I love on these interwebs? I just love Mr. Midnight Movie. I've always loved Mr. Midnight Movie. He's a nut. WBDR, I think it's .com. I don't know. Who knows? I'm all screwed up now. I don't know where it's at. Never mind. Forget it. I'm just going to end up being depressed now. Thanks a lot, Deshaun. Y'all got to hear this one day. Seriously, it's crazy. It's that damn good. I sent it to me in PDF. Rats. Rats and rats, rats. I looked under all my PDFs. This is called segue, bullshit, segue, talk. Oh, well. Did I look in documents already? I did, didn't I? Yeah, I did. Wait, is that it? Nope. What did I do with it? This is some really old stuff. Hold on, I'm looking one more place here. No, I don't see it. I see all these old chat logs. Does anybody know how to keep the chat logs on Spreaker.com? Because I figured it out all on my whittle self. It's pretty easy to do. Well, can't find it, so... Too bad. So sad. He's not even answering me. I don't believe this. Is Deshaun gone or what? Did he leave? That is so bad. That's so mean. No, I'm joking. No, it's not there. Oh, well. Next subject then. I guess I'll go ahead and kill it and close it out for the night. And thanks for everybody being here. And I can't believe he's not there. That is so weird. Where are you, Deshaun? What happened to you? That book was so good. It was amazing. There was parts of it that just, I can't get over it. So that's my reading tonight. And if anybody wants a reading, I do good damn readings. I just believe I do. I just think that I have some sort of a whim gift at it or something. I don't know what it is. Oh, hello. All right. always say Warner Brothers Doctor. Big D Country. Big D. Big D. So I'll just put in WBDR Big D Country. You're listening to Big D Country. Big D Country. Let's take a looky. And there it is. Do, 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 do. Oh, here we go. The Big D Zone. Big D. And the book is somewhere on here. Where is it? A Moose Bit My Brother. Oh, I'm live on there. Neat. I'm live on his website. Are you kidding me? That's great. I wonder where it is on here. I'll never know. Let's take a look. Don't Count Me Out. Oh, it's amazing. I have to buy it. Are you kidding me? Deshaun, what? I don't know. I want to buy it. I already have it. I have to buy it. Buy now. Aw, how sweet. Well, I guess I could buy it, but Dave, oh, Deshaun, are you kidding? Well, maybe next time I'll have it on here, but it's really good. I wish it was here on in download form. Maybe it's, no, it's not. Well, let's see, more. No, I can't, it's not on here. Oh, well. Wah, wah. He's got a bunch of news on here. He's going to be on all these different stations and stuff. That's great. Whatever. Yeah. Rock on. Rock on with your bad self. I love when I'm just sitting here just bloviating by myself and nobody to talk to. And I'm just sitting here just talking to myself. Wee, wee, wee. I love me. What? I'm not talking to you. What do you want? What? 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 What?
Hello. How you doing?
I don't know where your stupid book is. What did you do with your book? I can't find it.
Oh, that's okay. I'll send you another one. I'm sending you and David one, too. I was sending David one before you called me.
It is so good.
I was sending you on the chat room. I'm still here, and I'm still listening.
You are?
Yes,
I am.
I
was going to read some of it on the air because I'm just so, I'm so proud of it. It's so good.
Oh, well, thank you. Thank you so very much. And
so,
I just want to let
so
your
where listeners is it?
Know.
I'm joking. Do what, dear?
I just want to let your listeners know that when I win the White House in 2016, Debbie Daly will be the first lady, and she will be in the White House with me, and her family also is invited, so everybody could be in the White House with me as well. You know, the whole Debbie Daly crew is invited.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, see? Like that, what he said. So
that's
I get
right.
to fly in Air Force One, bitches.
That's right.
You
so
know,
Debbie will win. So keep the fight and don't listen to those trolls. You will never get anywhere by siding with those trolls. You will never get anywhere by giving up. Giving up is never the answer. You got to keep the fight and you got to keep on pushing because that's what I had to do even during my hard times in life. And I never give up. And look where I am. I finally get pen and approval from my heart. And you and everybody must be at the party when I do a party show. If my pen and approval becomes final, and we're gonna have a party.
Right on. When is your next show? And tell them about your show here on Spreaker.com.
So far, my next show is gonna be later on today at 3:00. We're doing a special crossfire. We're going to be talking about the typhoon help relief that's going on in the Philippines. And also we're going to talk about cyberbullying. Why is it wrong? We're going to talk about, the ways that we could all come together and just make the world a better place. So we're going to all talk about that on Crossfire.
Now, Wash.
Here you go.
E-S-H-O-N, incorrect. Now, L-2.
Shut up. Yeah, That's not very good. I was going to call in and read the news for you and Andy today, but I mean for you today because you were kind of having a hard time with it. But I don't know. I have mixed emotions about everything since Andy did what he did last night. What happened to Andy? He went kind of crazy on me there for a while, didn't he?
I didn't know what happened last night, but he wanted to know if you was mad at him. That's what he wanted to know.
I'm mad at him.
We just kind of straighten everything out, but he just wanted to say that he's all for everybody getting along, and that's why he's starting this petition. He's against cyberbullying, and he just want everybody to get along. That's all. He just wants peace in this world. And I agree. I agree in wanting peace because that's what I wanted when I'm president of the United States. I just want everybody to get along, even with the country and even with different shows. We could all have different shows together, come together. That's why I want to help different shows. That's why I helped your show. That's why I helped the radio, random radio network earlier. Uh-huh. And if we all just get on, it will be a perfect place.
I want to tell y'all something that's fairly recent out of the AP Wire. It came out in late October that a 12-year-old Rebecca Sedgwick committed suicide after a long period of online bullying. After her death, one of her tormentors went to Facebook to say, "Yeah, I bullied Rebecca and she killed herself." Then she went on to affirm in an obscenity-laced statement that she didn't care. She was glad she died. Sheriff Grady Judd of Polk County, Florida, was so outraged by that post that he arrested the 14-year-old little girl and the other 12-year-old little girl for probable cause. The girls were charged with aggravated stalking, a felony to be processed through juvenile court, and he said that he decided to move very quickly because he didn't want them to ruin anybody else's life. The sheriff hurled his harshest criticism at the parents at the arrest. The 14-year-old had been warned to stop by police before, but her parents did nothing. They failed to take away her cell phone, which she used to bully her online. The judge says, "I am aggravated that these parents are not doing what parents should do. After she is questioned and involved in this, why does she even have access to the internet?" Police said that the conflict began over a boy who once dated the now deceased girl and had been the boyfriend of the tormentor. Rebecca had been told in the bullying that went on for a long period that nobody liked her, that she should kill herself by drinking bleach. Others who knew the victim were warned by the 14-year-old bully that if they supported Rebecca, that they would also be bullied. Now, what does that remind you of? The bullying became so intense that Rebecca began to cut herself and was hospitalized for psychiatric care. Her mother eventually took her out of school and enrolled her in another school. But they did not stop the bullying, and Rebecca ended up committing suicide by jumping from an abandoned cement factory in Lakeland, Florida. The suicide of Rebecca Sedgwick is yet another sad case in a long line of bullying with a tragic ending. One wonders if childhood bullying or even adult bullying that leads to adult bullying, whether adult bullies influence young people to bully, either way, it is a stain on humanity. And I think that people that bully are human garbage. Human garbage. And the actual group that I'm dealing with here on Spreaker, this is what they do. They go to Facebook and there it's called rip page trolling. And they do it. Wild Goose is a pro at it. Moxie is a pro at it. They love it. That's what they do. They're in a group called the Bill Wagoner Crew. That's who you're dealing with, people, is trolls. And I know one of them named Sick the Tank. Sick the Tank has 11 kills, as he calls it, on his webpage that he has bullied so hard that they've committed suicide. And I find it amazing. They've told me many times to kill myself. I mean, and they've also gone to everybody that hangs out with me and said, if you hang out with her, if you call her show, we're going to get you too. Many times they've done that. Many times. They even did a YouTube video that said, now hear this. If anybody is caught calling Debbie's show on Blog Talk Radio, you will suffer the consequences. And I just wanted to add that. You brought up cyberbullying, and it's serious business, people. Somewhere there's a family that is crushed forever in the memory of their beloved daughter who got bullied by human garbage on the internet. Now, they'll never get to me. There's no doubt about it. They'll never get to me. I mean, fuck them. They're idiots. And I learned that at a very, very, very young age, Deshaun, that that when somebody picks on you, it's not me that's got the problem. It's them.
Exactly. It's them.
Absolutely. There's been so many of them. So many of them.
And they try to break your spirit. They try to stop your show. And you should not let them.
Does it sound like I'm letting them? No. Here I am.
You do a very good radio show, and you should not let these trolls try to take you off your show. This is your show. Just like the Big D Zone is my show. We could let whoever we want on, and we could do whatever we feel like, because this is our domain. And we're going to take our show and bring it to the next level. And that's what we do. That's what we do best.
Well, I don't know if I'll do that, but I enjoy what I do, and my kids are involved, and Victor loves it. He's in there listening right now. Hi, baby. And you know, it's something that everybody over here is very much into. So y'all can all bend over in your chair, put your head between your legs, and jump, as far as I'm concerned, right? Especially...
Now,
especially this person.
G-U-Y-S-H-E-A.
Watch him say, incorrect.
Incorrect. Now, watch.
And the worst one is this one.
G-O-O-F-Y-B-O-N.
Oh, snap.
Oh, snap.
And what is it going to say?
Well, thank you for calling in. I think my time is up for the night, and I'm getting tired.
I wanted to do a tribute show last week, but I wasn't able to get the song for you that you like, and also wanted to come into a special show to a special tribute to Debbie Daly.
Aw. How sweet. Call me Debbie.
Okay, I will, sweetie.
The internet is serious business, Nimbusters. The Nimbusters are okay. They're kind of harmless in a way. Just don't pay any attention to them. But if it makes you feel any better, watch this. This is called Power. 1, 2, 3. Boink. See you later, Nimbusters. Boink. They're gone.
See ya. Love ya.
The one thing I love about Spreaker is the power that you give. They give you to just ban these people. And I have a nice little list going of bands that I've done. And it's going to remain that way unless they come to me and say, can I get off the ban list? So thank you for calling in, Dash. And I just love the way Andy calls you Destin Porter.
That's right.
Destin Porter. ladies and gentlemen. He just gets all wound up. I just think it's so cute.
You know. Well, you know, he has a voice for radio, and I wanted to work on my team and wanted him to work at the presidential campaign. And I believe in Andy that will do a great job as a press director. And he knows a lot of people, and I am proud of the job that he's doing already and the job that he's doing against cyberbullying. And I believe that change.org will bring those petitions that are needed to be signed, because we can make a difference. And if just one person a day signed a petition, you know what? That's a step towards ending.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, our future candidate for the United States of America, I give you Destin Porter. What's up, Dustin? Give us your best speech for your presidency. What will you do? What would be the first thing you would do if you took office for the United States president, please?
My first thing, as day one, as soon as I'm sworn into office, I will make sure that our veterans are taken care of. Because it is our veterans that fought so hard to keep us free. It is our veterans, the men and women of the armed forces, that said that I will volunteer and I will fight for our great country. And we should not forget about the men and women who put on the uniform. So, day one, I'm going to work on a bill, and I'm going to work day and night to get a sign that there should be more people working in the VA to get paperwork done so that our veterans could get the services that they so desperately need to take care of their family, to put their children to college, because no veteran should suffer in shame. No veteran should say that they are not getting the help, and no veteran should say that we are forgetting about them. No, we want to be the country that we stand for our veterans. We will fight for our veterans every step on the way. My name is Deshaun Porter, and I believe in our country, and I believe our country is good. We are the United States of America.
Paid for by the Deshaun 2016 campaign. Yay! Wouldn't it be wild if you got on the ticket?
I know, right?
I mean, on the ballot? Ballot
that
ticket?
That would be crazy. I mean, you know, the support that I'm getting now, and that with David being a campaign manager, Annie and Ernie is the community organizer, and then you being first lady, what would you like to do for the campaign, dear?
I just want to stand there and look good. That's it. I just want to wear those beautiful suits. I want to wear a pink suit just like Jackie did, and a beautiful pink suit, and just stand there behind you and smile and wave. I would probably redecorate the White House. I'm kidding,
well,
of course.
Well, you'd be able to do that as first lady.
I would do something for education and for animal rights. I am disgusted with what goes on in dog pounds. I don't want to talk about it. I don't even want to talk about what they do. People, please adopt a dog from a dog pound if you can, please. I mean, it's don't go there, Debbie. I can't go there. I don't even want to think about it. I can't think about it. So I would do something about that. I don't know what I would do. I would do something to stop these puppy mills that they've got. It's disgusting. A targeted individual named Charles Langenberg showed up dead on November the 8th. He was a targeted individual for 6 years. He was a whistleblower for the Safeway Corporation and told some stuff that they don't think he should have been telling. And it was very, very sad. If you want to hear his tribute, go to my friend. He's called The News Guy. Listen to what he did today. He did a complete tribute to that man, and it was very good, very well done. So this is Debbie with...
And it just so happens that he asked me to sing a couple of songs, which I did. That was my voice that did on...
Your voice what, dear?
That's my voice that you heard a couple of songs. I sang Memories from Cats. I sang... Hard to Say Goodbye, Boys to Men, and I sang The Way We Were. Those were my voices that you heard.
I didn't know that. Now, I got up and started doing laundry at one point, and Heather was talking to me, and the baby was there, and Victor and everything, so I didn't really hear all of it, but absolutely. I'm going to play a song on the way out, and this is dedicated to my girlfriend, Audrey. I will be saying goodnight to Deshaun, and good night to everybody out there that's been listening. And for those of you that are listening in the future, this is dedicated to my lovely Audrey. I love you, Audrey.
Can tear you apart. Still